Hello and welcome to The Sound of Science. Did you ever wonder how our brain is able to perceive that we are located next to a dangerous cliff or next to a tall wall or any kind of border? And also, did you ever think about how others perceive our location or presence near a dangerous cliff or other border? To understand this, we need to understand how our brain navigates in space. One of the brain regions that is mostly involved in spatial learning and memory is the hippocampal formation that you can see here in this animation prepared using the Allen Brain Atlas. And you can see both the hippocampal formation as well as adjacent cortical regions that are involved in encoding spatial learning and memory. You can also see this brain region, the hippocampus, in this animation of the human brain, also from the Allen Brain Atlas. You can see here the hippocampal formation within the human brain. This is the ventral hippocampus, and above it the dorsal hippocampus, which is mostly involved in spatial learning and memory, more so than the ventral hippocampus. So it is very difficult to study the human brain with respect to spatial learning and memory, and specifically in the hippocampus, because it is difficult to penetrate with electrodes to the brain of a living person. However, it is quite possible using animal models such as rodents, and indeed, most of the research in this field was done using mice and rats. And indeed, studies in rodents were able to show that there are place fields located in the hippocampus that can encode the location of an animal within the environment. Similarly, there are grid cells in the entorhinal cortex that can signal the location of an animal within a grid in the environment. So these cells fire action potentials in a form of grid within the environment. And it's interesting to see that there is a mathematical rule for the encoding of the fields within the grid, as you can see here in this hexagon that is being formed between the fields of the grid cell. Another cell type that was found is a border cell that these cells can fire action potentials at a higher rate when the animal gets close to a border in its environment. However, all these cells and many other cells that I haven't mentioned were found in rodents in an experiment that enables the researchers to pinpoint the exact location and identity of these cells. This is not the case in humans. Another characteristic of cells that participate in spatial learning and memory is that they fire action potentials at a particular rhythm, which is called theta waves, which is 4 to 12 action potentials within a second, so 4 to 12 hertz. A relatively recent study was able to show in humans that the medial temporal lobe encodes theta rhythms when a person navigates in space and is located next to a border. In this study, the authors utilized functional MRI, which showed them that there is a particular metabolic activity in the medial temporal lobe of individuals that were navigating in space near borders of the environment. They also used intracranial EEG, which enabled them to study the electrical activity of the cells in that brain region. However, in that study, the researchers studied non-moving subjects. So these subjects were either seated or they stood, and they had a virtual reality apparatus, or let's say a computerized apparatus or interface, in which the environment was projected in front of them. So they virtually walked in the environment. Also, in this study, they were able only to record the self-location of the individual next to a border. In a recent study that was published on December in the journal Nature by the groups of Itzhak Fried and Nanthia Suthana, the researchers were able to show that using IEEG, which means intracranial EEG, in moving subjects, that the subjects are able to both indicate their own location near a border as well the location of others near a border. So how were they able to do that? they made use of the fact that there were several patients that were implanted with a system called RNS by a company called the NeuroPace. You can see a schematic of this apparatus taken from this company's website. And this apparatus is implanted under the scalp, as you can see here. And it has a recording electrode as well as a stimulating electrode. And this apparatus is able to record the baseline neuronal activity of that particular brain region. And when it identifies an abnormal electrical activity, as in the case of epilepsy, it is able to stimulate that brain region until the baseline activity of the brain region is restored. And this is a treatment that can be administered to individuals that no longer respond to drugs aimed at treating epilepsy. So what was the experimental paradigm in this study? So the first experimental paradigm was there was an observer in the room, and the subjects were told to go to a particular cue on one of the walls, and then they were told to look for a hidden target in the room. So for example, this is the target, and after the subjects learned that this is the location of the hidden target, they were allowed to again participate in this trial. This time they had to find the target's location based on their memory. So what the researchers were able to find was that during the periods of time in that experiment that the individuals or the participants of the study got close to a border, specifically within 1.2 meters, there was a significant theta wave activity in their medial temporal lobe. Specifically, they were able to show that this theta activity was induced when the participants specifically were looking for a target rather than just roaming in the environment. Next, the investigators wanted to see whether the participants are able to perceive the other's location next to a given border. So to conduct this experiment, what the researchers did was to place this time the individuals that are being recorded as observers, and someone else, a participant, was given the same kind of task to go to a particular cue within the room and then look for a hidden target. Following acquisition of this hidden target, the participant again had to roam in the room until it found the location of the target. During this time, the observer observed the actions of the participant and its brain activity was recorded. So what the researchers saw also in this case was that, again, when the participants of the study got close to the edge of the room, to the border of the room, there was a significant theta activity in their medial temporal lobe. And so while investigators were able to show that humans can encode the border in their environment as well as when someone else is located in a border, they still don't know the identity of the cells that participate in this process, as well as they don't know the specific subregion of the medial temporal lobe or perhaps even within the hippocampus that is involved in this process. Another important and interesting issue that future studies will help to answer is whether during a navigational task we're able to encode the presence of multiple individuals next to borders in the environment, or in other words, assess whether there are multiple parallel spatial maps encoded in our brain. And so in this very interesting study, researchers were able to show using chronic recordings from human brains that we're able to perceive our own presence near a border of our environment, as well as to perceive when others are located in that environment. So with that, I will conclude. I hope you enjoyed, and I'll see you on the next video. Until then, stay safe.